Good evening, I'm James Goodill. You're watching The Digital Age. You've heard the phrase, haven't you? Big Brother's watching you, or Big Brother's listening to you. But how about this? Is Big Brother reading your email? And if Big Brother is reading your email, how much of your email is he reading? All? A lot? We have a guest tonight who's got some startling conclusions on this subject, and he is James Bamford. Thank you very much for coming back. Jim, we haven't seen you for a couple of years. You've got a new book in the process called The Shadow Palace.
Shadow Factory.
Oh. Shadow Factory. What was your first one?
Puzzle Palace.
Puzzle Palace.
Yes, sir.
I'm sorry about that. And it's about the National Security Agency. Let's get into this question whether the government's reading your emails. When we talk about the government reading your emails, what do we mean by the government?
Well, NSA's job is to eavesdrop on communications, and that includes digital information such as email. So NSA has been given the responsibility of basically censoring all the email coming in, going out, and going through the United States. It's part of what the Bush administration considered its terrorism, a war on terrorism.
Let's go back in time. When we had the first book here that I half introduced, and let's look at what the NSA has always done. And I mean, we think of the NSA, what, as a place where breaking codes and what else?
Making codes, breaking codes, and intercepting information.
And how were the intercepts done historically?
Well, historically, basically from the 60s to the mid-90s, most of the interception by NSA was done by large satellite dishes. Most international communications was transmitted by dishes that would send signals up to satellites. They would bounce down to other dishes. So it was mostly satellite communications that NSA was after. That's how international communications was transmitted. And again, that was mostly from the 60s to the mid to late 90s. And then there was a switch, particularly because of all the internet communications.
We have the digital age. I mean, the digital age really landed hard on the NSA, didn't it?
Yeah, it landed very hard on the NSA. The NSA, as we just said, has been doing it the same way for a very, very long time, and all of a sudden everything changed. And one of the reasons it changed was the digitalization of communications, packet switching, all the ways that communications can be transmitted now, and also the fact that it became much cheaper, much more efficient to send communications on undersea fiber optic cables than it is to send it by satellite.
And it's pretty tough to send emails by satellite too, isn't it?
Well, the problem is the bandwidth. I mean, satellites can only handle so much bandwidth. And on voice communications, you have a small time delay, a half-second time delay or whatever, because your satellite's 22,330 miles up in space. And then you also have atmospheric conditions that can inhibit the communications to some degree. So most of the telecom companies began switching a lot of their facilities or switching a lot of their communications to undersea and underground fiber optic cables. That left NSA out there
holding the bag.
Yeah, holding their ears open to trying to hear.
They couldn't hear anything.
No, because they're used to hearing through these big dishes hidden in places around the U.S. and also around the world. And they were getting deafer, more and more deaf as the years were going on in the late 90s. And then all of a sudden they were hearing almost nothing. So that was that coincided with around the time of 9/11. Prior to 9/11, NSA was still trying to do it the old-fashioned way, which was eavesdrop on satellite communications. And the beauty of that, eavesdropping on satellite communications, is that you don't have to tell anybody you're doing it. You just put a big dish out there.
That's right.
In a hidden location like Sugar Grove, West Virginia, which is a big valley in a place called a radio quiet zone, where there's no other electricity or any kind of transmissions around for miles and miles. And you just pick up the signal. So you don't have to have any cooperative agreements with the telecom companies or anything.
What did you have to do, by the way, if you wanted to say about this period of time, you wanted to go after the cable? You say to yourself, okay, I don't have to have any agreements and so forth and so on, but I'm not getting everything. I know the cable's there.
Yeah.
What would you do, get a submarine? What the heck was the NSA doing?
Well, there's two ways of doing it, basically. You can get a submarine. They did design a submarine to do that.
Oh, they did?
The USS Jimmy Carter.
Really?
Yeah. Especially designed to go down and tap into undersea cables. But those are, you know, it's very, from people I've talked to, it's a good idea, but they still haven't gotten it to work.
Oh, really? It didn't work
yet. No, it's very difficult, you know.
I didn't realize that. So it's not only they were, so they're really stuck. So they can't, there's no way for them to get the
They used to be able to do it when they were copper cables. They could tap into those. But tapping undersea fiber optic cables is much more difficult.
It.
And they haven't been able to do it yet.
Oh,
so the only other alternative is to make secret agreements with the telecom companies. And that's what they did. After 9/11, they began making these secret agreements with AT&T and other companies. And the way it would work was they would actually go into the big switches. These are huge.
Okay, why don't we show a AT&T employee telling what he learned as being part of the being in those buildings with these new switches?
Sure. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
In 2003, an AT&T engineer notices that the cables on the seventh floor have been rerouted, and a mirror image of all the traffic, both domestic and international, is now being sent to a secret room one floor below.
It was obvious that this was some kind of NSA installation. I figured out that what they were doing was a blind wholesale copying of the entire internet data flow. And this meant randomly scooping up huge amounts of purely domestic data as well as international data.
How are they, and Jim, how are they doing that actually? I mean, we got the picture of the guy scooping him, saying all the data is being scooped up, but what, did they build a house or how do they,
what
did they do?
The way they do it is, in San Francisco, that's where a lot of the Asian and Far Eastern communications come in. The way it comes in is these are undersea cables. There's about a dozen of them, between eight and a dozen cables that come into the West Coast. And on the NOVA program, we actually showed how they come into this one spot at Morro Bay. And then they go to this one building at very near Morro Bay, which is owned by the AT&T. And from there it goes on up to San Francisco. So what happens is when the cables go into San Francisco to that big switch that you just saw on the TV, these are fiber optic cables. So these are fibers with photons flowing through them. And they go into this device called a splitter box. Splitter box is basically a prism. It's a glass, I mean, sophisticated glass prism.
Right.
So that it takes this these fibers and it basically duplicates them so that they come into the splitter box as one cable. Well, you've got more than one cable, but each cable goes in there, and then there's a duplicate of each of those cables coming out because they've been split and duplicated. Like a clone. There's like a clone of each of these cables coming out of that box. So one side of that cable containing all the digital information goes where it's supposed to go. If it's an email from Kuala Lumpur to Kansas City, it goes on its way. But now the clone cable, the duplicate, goes down one floor below to that secret room that Mark Klein described. And in that secret room is all this gear, NSA's equipment, to filter through all that data. So right now the watch list is over half a million names. So you got all those names that would be in the computers. You've got words, phrases that they're looking for, keywords that may trigger NSA's surveillance. So you have all that data flowing in, and then whatever contains that one of those names on the list or a word or a phrase gets kicked out and sent to NSA for further analysis. So in other words, you've got basically all this information coming in. Now, what we were just talking about was the international cables. What makes it very interesting, and what Mark Klein was discussing, was that in San Francisco, it's not just international cables, but it's domestic cables that go into that same facility. So into those splitter boxes go not only the international cables, but domestic cables. So what NSA is filtering, eavesdropping on, are both international and domestic communications.
This thing, to hear you explain this, and I've heard about this before, it's absolutely extraordinary. I hadn't focused on the fact that the NSA has its own cable. Did all these cables, I think you answered this question, but the domestic and the international cables were all coming to the same spot anyway in San Francisco.
Right.
And so the NSA knew that. And so all the NSA had to do was talk the phone companies in to permit it. What it's really doing is just making a copy of the cable.
Exactly, it's making a copy of the cable. Now,
I mean, but this in history, if eavesdropping, I mean, there's never been anything like this, because when you put your antenna up in there, maybe you got them and maybe you didn't get them, but here you've got everything. Everything in one spot. Well, I guess there's six spots, though, are they? Throughout the country?
Well, there's Mark Klein said that there's, he was at AT&T. He talked to other people, and he thought that there were probably, possibly up to a dozen other locations where, because you got the East Coast, you got the West Coast, and what's interesting here also is that if NSA just wanted the international communications, it would build that secret room down at that facility in San Luis Obispo, which is right near Morro Bay, because that's where all the international cables come in. But by building it in San Francisco, you're getting not just the international, but you're getting international and domestic. So that, should be worrying to a lot of people.
Well, so they said to themselves, our job really is to get international traffic, particularly the traffic that's in, which is United States connected. So if somebody's trying to persuade somebody in San Francisco to be a terrorist, we pick that up. But that would be an international call. But now they're saying, that's not good enough for it. We've got to get all domestic traffic. So how did they ever talk to phone companies into letting them do this?
Well, what's interesting, this is the third time they've done that. They did it after World War II. After World War II, censorship ended, and the predecessor to NSA was faced with the same problem. How are we going to get access to communications? At the time, it was, instead of email, it was telegrams. And they actually talked to the telegram companies, Western Union and so forth, into secret agreements with the government, where they handed over all the telegrams entering, leaving, or going through the United States. And that went on for almost 30 years. That was called Operation Shamrock.
And what period of time was that again?
Well, that was 1946, I'd say.
76?
To about 75, when the Church Committee
discovered
it. And
they got all the telegrams.
I'm sorry, yeah, and they got all the telegrams. It was actually, the way it worked, NSA set up a secret facility in New York. It was made to look like a television tape processing company. And they'd have somebody from NSA go out to Western Union and the other companies, or about two or three other companies that did this, just after midnight every night, and they'd knock on the back door, and somebody there would hand them
all the telegrams?
They were all on computer discs. So, and they'd hand them all to them, and then they'd go back to this television tape processing company, and they'd actually, which was just the phony cover name for the NSA's office there, and they'd duplicate all those take them several hours.
And the NSA discovered that and made them stop?
Well, no, the NSA was doing this. And
I mean, the Church Committee made them stop?
Yeah, and then they get the tapes back to the company before the morning shift came in, and they send the duplicates down to NSA. So the Church Committee discovered this Operation Shamrock in 75, there was actually a criminal investigation by the FBI and Justice Department into it. So, yeah, they had to stop, and that's one of the reasons they created the Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Court, to prevent that from happening again. So, once again, this is what's happening now, is that the Bush administration went back to the telecom companies and, again, said, we need your secret cooperation to do this. And once again, the telecom company said, okay, despite the law, it's a criminal statute. It says...
It's pretty clear.
Yeah, and it's punishable by 5 years in prison for every time it's violated, which means every single person, not just, you know... you're talking about a lot of prison time for doing it. So all of a sudden, it's discovered. The New York Times, December 16th, 2005, comes out with their story. And so now all of a sudden the world knows that the NSA has been secretly eavesdropping, and now the telecoms are getting very nervous that they're going to be prosecuted or sued. And there were 50 lawsuits against the companies, more than 50 lawsuits. So they were asking for immunity, and that's what was one of the critical factors in this whole new legislation, whether or not to grant immunity to the telecom companies. Because they just said okay to the government and did it.
What now? What's your position with respect to the amount of emails that are being read of Americans? You've described to us the cable that is, or I guess the cable that has U.S. emails in them, is a duplicate's being made. Is your position that all emails of United States citizens are being read?
Well, all I can do is do the best I can. This is my third book on NSA, so I spent a lot of time looking at NSA, and the best I can do is come up with the information that I have. And whether every single email in the country is being read, I have no idea. I just know
what do
that
you think?
There's a lot. I think there's probably maybe 75%. I don't know.
75%?
Again, that's just a guess based on...
75% of all emails are being read by the government?
Well, not being read by the government, but are being accessed by the government. I mean, a lot of these are...
So that's why I asked the question the way I did. So now what do you mean by that?
Well, the way I described it was that you have the second cable coming down, duplicate cable, going into the NSA room. All that goes through a machine.
Is that the 75%?
Well, I think they probably have access to 75%. Based on what Klein was saying, other people were saying, it sounds like there's probably, who knows, maybe 75%, maybe 100%, maybe 50%. Somewhere a lot of communications. There's a lot of communications. It doesn't mean they're reading everything. All it means is that those communications are going through an NSA filter. Now, if you're... if your name is John Doe and you're communicating with Mary Doe, and Mary Doe and John Doe are not on the watch list, and you're talking about recipes or something, I mean, the odds are there's not going to be anybody ever reading that. It's just going to go right through.
But the guy gentleman we showed from AT&T, said they're listening to American conversations, the implication being they're really old conversations. And there was another part in your Nova show, which, by the way, if I can plug your Nova show, you can see by going to the PBS website. There are parts of the part we showed we took from the website. And you have in there a young lady who had been in the Army, and she said, gee, she got embarrassed because she's listening to such personal conversations.
Yeah, I mean, you gotta be very careful because there's big distinctions about how they handle email and how they handle telephone calls and all that. Each one is, you can't lump them all together. What Klein was talking about at AT&T was email. He wasn't talking about telephone calls.
Right, and that's what we're talking about today, too, right?
Yeah.
Digital age.
Yeah, so email, they could filter emails very, fairly easily and efficiently by diverting clones of the cables or duplicate cables into a room and filter it all through.
Well, it's filtered. By filtered, you mean data mining?
Well, data mining is a bit different. I guess you could lump that into the category of data mining, but basically what you're talking about is filtering. In other words, you know, you've got a computer there, and the computer is loaded with maybe over 500,000 names on the watch list, words, and it's more sophisticated than just saying bomb or something. I mean, you have to have a lot of combination of, it's like doing a Google search. You put a specific string of words together, hoping that you're going to find somebody that's involved in terrorism or whatever. So you have these strings of words and phrases and so forth. And that's what goes through, you know, at the speed of light. All this communications are going through. And the only thing that gets things that get kicked out and then actually sent to NSA for further analysis are the communications that meet the criteria, you know, the protocols that are fed into the computers. So if, you know, if your name
is John. Yeah, but I mean, this is blind man's buff or the reverse, because I could say to you something like, good morning, it's April 1st, and the world beware. And that might, you know, that might be a fun thing that we say to each other.
Yeah.
That might have been the very words that hit the computer system that pulls them out. So everyone's at risk having their email read. There's no way to limit the amount of email that's being read. It's just sort of disgraceful, isn't it? Or what do you think?
Well, you know, if you, you know, there's two ways of looking at this thing. One of them is that they've been doing this for a long time to some degree, even when they had the dishes. They
were not like this.
Not exactly like this.
They didn't read our mail. I mean, we used to write mail. We don't write letters anymore. We write emails.
Exactly.
No one read our mail all the time.
I know. Yeah, I mean, that's the change.
Let me read you. This is out of a ACLU brief that talks about the law that put into effect, or not put into effect, which rationalized what you and I have been talking about, was an amendment to the FISA Act. We'll talk about that in a sec.
Yeah.
But here's what the ACLU says about it. The government can obtain a mass acquisition order without identifying the people or the group of people to be surveilled, without specifying the facilities, places, premises, or property to be monitored, without specifying the particular communications to be collected, without obtaining individualized warrants based on criminal or foreign intelligence probable cause, and without making even a prior administrative determination that the acquisition relates to a particular foreign agent or foreign power. We've never had that system before.
Well, I agree.
Country.
That's why I joined the ACLU suit against NSA.
I didn't know that. I should have been full disclosure. Oh, you have? Well, I didn't realize that.
Yeah, no, I was one of the first plaintiffs to join the ACLU suit against NSA about this.
Oh, you were.
I'm just trying to, you know, there's nobody here from NSA. I'm trying to tell you what their position is on this thing.
Well, I'll take you.
Not just my position.
I'll take you.
My position is obviously I'm against it. I wrote a whole book about it, and I joined a lawsuit against NSA. That's what NSA says, is that NSA says we haven't intercepted the communications until we've actually pulled them out. So all those other communications that go into the filter and then come out of the filter without being sent to NSA, they don't consider that they've intercepted it.
Uh-huh. But they might intercept the wrong ones, though, that they pull out.
But what we did on Nova, just to show how easy it is to get pulled in, I was in Kuala Lumpur, and I was typing out a memo to our executive producer in Boston of Nova, and it contained words like the memo had to do with the program, and I said, you know, we're looking into how the terrorists considered bombing the Capitol and blowing up the White House. And so, you know, you had these phrases in there, bomb the Capitol, blow up the White House, and those are precisely the kind of things that would be pulled out once they get to San Francisco, even though it was a very innocent
so what happened?
Conversation.
Well, you got away with it.
Well, who knows? Because NSA.
Or they may have picked it out.
NSA doesn't tell you whether.
Oh, you don't. They don't know.
So we're just showing how once what we did was show typing out that email and then showed how the route that email took under the various oceans and under the Pacific, yeah. and then to the U.S. and then to San Francisco, where it would probably be picked out in that room. So we just showed the flow. It was the first time, as far as I know, anybody's ever shown exactly how the system works from beginning to end. So what we've been talking about is data communications, email, digital communications, and so forth. And then, you know, if you want to talk about telephone conversations, that's a different technology.
So is there an argument the other way?
I'm sorry?
Is there an argument? Does the government have an argument that fits into the history of protecting our privacy, or is the government's argument...
You mean on email? What it's, you know, the government did all this secretly without ever getting any authorization from Congress or the Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Court, which is a violation of the.
But then they changed the law.
So between 2001 and say 2006 or so, the government was the Bush administration was operating illegally. Then they did change the law to accommodate the way it's being done. And they did incorporate the Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Court into the system, but not to the extent that it was before. So that, I mean, the real protections there are that those names that go into those computers. In other words, before they put your name into the computer, they should have a judge from the FISA court say, yes, there's probable cause that this person is involved
they shouldn't
under FISA.
They shouldn't have picked up your email if they picked it up unless they'd gone to the FISA court before and said, this guy's Bamford's dangerous. And the NSA sued you a few times anyway, haven't they?
No.
Threatened.
They threatened me a few times, that's all. I mean, in my first book, The Puzzle Palace, they threatened me with prosecution twice. Yeah. On my second book, Body of Secrets, they had a book signing for me at NSA. So I've had this sort of love-hate relationship.
Okay,
now they don't like me anymore because I just
like
sued them.
Well, we won't like you with this book either for the lawsuit. Well, look, we've reached the end of the show. I take it your suit, it turns out, will try to say that the FISA amendment about which we just talked, that theoretically permits what we've talked about, is unconstitutional because it violates our rights of privacy, which lawyers use by the fancy name of the Fourth. It's a Fourth Amendment violation, but this violates our privacy. So I'll ask you.
But the suit's already gone through the whole system. We won a lower court. The district court judge found in U.S. Found in the favor of the ACLU, and then it went up to an appeals court. And the appeals court had three judges. Two of those judges were appointed by the Bushes, Bush 1 and Bush 2, and one judge was appointed by, I think it was by Carter.
So we lost by two to one.
So
is the Supreme Court going to take it?
They denied certiorari.
You lost.
So we lost, exactly.
So is the government reading our, Big Brother reading our email, and there's nothing we can do about it? What's the answer to those questions?
Yes, they are, and
yes,
no,
and yes.
We can't.
Thanks a lot for coming by, James Bamford.
Appreciate you.
And thank you for coming by. Come by next week and learn more about the digital age. For the digital age, I am James Goodale. Good night.